Right, you pricks, you were right. She was a fucking boy, so why am I still calling her a shit? I don't give a fuck. Kubo pulling out traps out of his ass, I don't care. People saying, oh, that's a boy's name. How the fuck do you guys know? You guys don't talk Japanese, and if you do, then sorry, but still, stop being a bastard. You guys thought that as much as I did as well. But this is great as well, do you know why? Because this could actually turn Soifan straight. I mean, you saw them eyes. She wanted it. No, but in all seriousness, the first time reading this chapter, I was a bit like, oh, is that it? But I read it a few more times, and I found it quite interesting to talk about. Now, yes, the first four pages was recap, but from a different perspective, and I'm pretty sure that the Squad Zero members were the only ones that were there, as well as the Soul King. But we can see in this that there is guards actually guarding the Soul King still. If you think about it, what's the fucking point? If someone's got to that place in the first place, then that takes it that Squad Zero are already down, so what are these fodder fucking guards gonna do? Yes, and your watch has stabbed the Soul King, but as I said last time, I don't think he's dead because he is frozen and nothing's really being affected. It's not like he's gonna bleed to death, his whole body's frozen, it's not active. So that's why the end of the world hasn't kind of happened yet and all the things have gone into collapse. And that's why I think he's froze himself, also because the Soul King had this foreseeable future that this would happen. That's why he froze himself. That's my theory. And also, it's nice to see Ryuki once in a while. And we now know what Uehara was drawing in the ground. It looks like that's where the secret base is. And it's like a fucking TARDIS because as soon as you walk in, it looks massive. But here's what's interesting to me. When Kisuke was talking about the other captains, for example, Komamura, they requested for a medical team and got denied for some reason. And saying that the third and ninth captains are going to be joined with Kuritsuchi. Obviously, that's Kensei and Rose. And then we get to a certain panel showing Kuritsuchi with two pods look like bolts. And what he's doing, who the fuck knows, but is this a way of turning them back to the way they were? Or is this just simply keeping them stable? Many questions what Kuritsuchi is doing there. Kenpachi's in critical condition, as you can expect. The motherfucker went to space and back. And Kyoku's gone to room 46, which is actually Central 46. That just does my head in. That does actually, for some reason, that annoys me. But here's the kicker. He says he hasn't received any word about the 10th Division Hitsugaya yet. Now, of course, Kuritsuchi said about Kensei and Rose because he saw them, but surely he must have saw Kuritsuchi as well, and he must have explained about Tashiro. Either that, or is that just a hint that, you know, Hitsugaya never survived what Kuritsuchi had in plan? Now, what is Urahara making, anyway? He's standing outside a bunch of posts, which are emitting reishi, which he needs the captains to be there to make that reishi grow. Is it just going to be a big beam to get to the Soul Palace that will break all what 70, is it 72 or 70 something barriers to the Soul Palace? Because of course, as you know, the Soul Palace has a massive defense mechanism. So using all that reishi in a beam to kind of blast away a hole to get through there, who knows? I reckon that is the case. And I mean, if I wasn't just walked through the fucking door, that shit would already be sorted and ready to go. But that's why I think he stayed behind, because if Aizen is going to come back, obviously Aizen's going to need to get to the Soul Palace, so only Kisuke Urahara knows how to sort that out. He knows how to build a gateway into the Soul Palace. And another thing, where's like Hiyori? I didn't see Hiyori once. Hiyori's awesome. Where is she? It would have been fitting as well, like for comedy purpose, because Shinji's there as well. And sure, I would have loved to have known a bit more about what the heavenly armor was that is being used to create this beam, but maybe next chapter, eh? But he sounded so serious and badass when he said, we're gonna break into the Soul Palace, let's fucking do this. And then of course, Ichibei like saying, sorry humans, but you can't defeat your boss. You just fucking sent him out there, you dickhead. Now of course, the only reason why I can think why he said this is because, well, maybe he's just realized that he's just stabbed the Soul King, and because of him stabbing the Soul King, something's going to change in your watch, I'm guessing. That's the only possible reason why I can see him rapidly changing his mind like that. But yeah, I'm keeping it at that. Soifan, Rukia for the motherfucking win, I love seeing them. We got Yashiro's gender, yes. Okay, you can tell me in the comments, oh yeah, you were right, cool, I don't give a fuck. Fuck you guys. Kisuke's reasoning for staying and not going with Yoda Witcher and all that kind of gets explained a little bit more. What's Kuritsuchi doing with them people in the pod? And why the sudden change of Ichibei? But that's all I have for you today, guys. You guys, of course, have this fine day been handsomed. I'll catch you motherfuckers later, and peace out. By the way, Kubo, don't waste any more chapters on Omaida. It's cool to see that he's alive and well and all that, but no more. That'd be great, thanks.